lost in the rabbit hole. Connect every emotion, experience, adventure, struggle, pain, and achievement. Know the past, feel the future, and live this moment with Misha Harale. Every Sunday on Niche Radio. Hi everyone, and thank you for tuning in to our 10th episode of Let's Get Lost in the Rabbit Hole with me, Nisha Harale, on Niche Radio. And in conversation with me today is the man who created the Mutant Theater. He also composed the music for the movie The Matrix, and he has set the floor on fire across the globe with his absolutely amazing music. Yes, let's say hello to Juno Reactor. Hi Juno, and thank you for joining us. Are you all set to get lost in the rabbit hole?
Well, I've heard that rabbit holes are quite dangerous, so I'm not sure.
So let's get to our first question. I want to understand why the name Juno Reactor.
Juno, the first part of Juno Reactor comes from Juno, which was the wife of Jupiter in Roman mythology. And gods, goddesses, and it was part of the triple goddess. And in those days, like, the goddesses would generally all have the name Juno in front of it. So there'd be like Juno, Regina, and there'd be a whole list of them. And so the idea of Juno Reactor was like a powerhouse of like the ancient pagan goddesses. Mixed with sort of the reactor of like nuclear reactors and the modern world, and it seemed to sum up everything that I wanted to do, which was cross musics, ancient music and electronics. And in those days it was quite hard to do, you know, so I'd go around the place recording lots of different people and come back into the studio and put it all together. I mean, that's how it sort of started, really, and that's why the name is there.
I'm sure you had many moments through your journey, but what are the five top moments that you would like to share with our listeners?
Five's quite a lot. I think in Juno Reactor, it was a nice collision working with the guys at the very beginning, like Mike Maguire, Stefan Holvec. I mean, Mike was like the first person I'd start working with, and he was working in a distribution company in London, and we just really clicked. And I'd already been working with Stefan, whose main project is called Total Eclipse. And Mike would go and spend maybe 6 months a year in India, and he'd come back and say, Ben, we've really got to try and do some of these because these parties are so happening. And he would come back with the information, some sort of ideas as well, and we'd start writing. And just, it wasn't for commercial release, it was just ready so that he could DJ these tracks in the parties that were happening out in the jungle. And there was Johan Blay that I met on the first album, who again was living in Goa for 6 months a year, and this was like sort of 1990. Might have been 1980. No, it was 1990. So I suppose that's the first one. The next was going off to Africa with the record label, and we recorded the San people in Namibia. And we spent a number of days in the desert there, recording their songs and filming their dances. And that's when I first met Mabee. I was recording a Zulu band in Johannesburg, and I sort of fell over him in the corridor because he was asleep, which was quite funny. And then I found out who's this amazing percussionist. And in the next studio along, was this band called Amanpondo, which was like a really traditional South African percussion group. And this band that I was producing, which was a Zulu band called Skeleton, I got all of Amanpondo and Mabie to come in and play the percussion. And it was amazing. And when I got, I suppose then the next section is when I got offered the Moby tour of America by my manager. The English guys didn't really want to go and just sort of like play for half an hour for a month in front of Moby. So I said to Amanpondo and Moby, hey, do you fancy this? You know, it could be a laugh. And they just jumped at the opportunity to go. And I think that was like really a breaking point, you know, where I just went, wow, this is amazing, this type of live improvised percussion with the electronic. And we put on, we were, as we did the tour, the stage show got better and better and we'd put more things in it. And we could really improvise a lot. We could stop, you know, the machines that I was using and just go into full percussion and song, dance. And it made me think very differently electronically, and I really learned a lot about percussion through them. I still got a lot to learn anyway, but I learned a lot through them and the fun of it, really. A lot of it is fun, you know, the fun of the dance, the fun of the percussion, the exploration of the instruments, and it was a massive eye-opener. And then I suppose next along came The Matrix, and that was a shock because they invited me out for an interview, and I went to LA and they said, we'd like you to do this freeway chase. And we just got on, we really got on as people. And so they invited me out, I went out there, and I just, every time I finished, when I finished the first cue, they said, well, how about this cue? And so every time I'd done a track, that they'd really like it and green light it, and then we'd do the next one, and it just carried on like a snowball. I suppose that experience of doing Matrix 2 and Matrix 3 are the most amazing years of, or experiences of, my musical life. And working with Don was hard at first, but then became really good. And I think, you know, it was like being in a vortex. You know, there was so much work and it was really long hours, and you felt like you were in this sort of tunnel. And when you come out the other end, I was completely exhausted and wasn't quite prepared for how much work was really needed. But it was like going to university of scoring films and learning off really good people, like Zig Gron, who was my music editor, and Joey Ran. And obviously the Wachowskis were like amazing to work with. They were completely non-ego. So that was amazing. And then lastly, the Mutant Theatre came about through doing a show at Azora with the band, the Juno Reactor band. And they really liked it. And they said, how about coming back next year with a different show? And I'd had this Mutant Theatre idea in my head for about 5 years. And I'd met two different performance groups. One is Agnevo from Moscow, and the other one is the Stigma Show from St. Petersburg. And I thought it'd be a great idea to put them together and call it the Mutant Theatre, and then have the band as well, and then work on a show. But the way it happened was that essentially we got to Azora maybe 2 days before, and we did lots of rehearsals and ideas, and we really created the show over those 2 days before the first performance. And then next year we did a few more performances, and then we ended up playing in Caesar's Palace in Las Vegas. And that's, you know, I'd say that's possibly the best show, visual show, that Juno Reactor has been able to accumulate. And really great people. I'd say that with all the people in Juno Reactor, whether it's like from management through to the road crew, to the band, to the performers, it feels like an extended family. And I think that's when you know it's good.
During your journey, there was a period when Juno Reactor had toured with Moby in America. How was that journey?
I sort of went through that a little bit, but it was interesting because we were all stuck on a bus. There were about 12 of us on one big bus that we all slept on, and started off, I think, in Seattle. And on the first night, because we were only playing 30, 35 minutes a night, and some venues were nice and big, others were like little sort of bars almost, you know. I think some down near Portland and places like that, they were quite sort of cozy. But it was good because Moby would always come out and watch what the Amapondo and Mabi were doing and sort of clock it. And so it was just a great experience because, again, we would like work on the show every night and get back into the bus and come up with new ideas for the next night and then try them out in rehearsals. And it was like a snowball effect, so that by the time we finished like 25, 30 dates or whatever it was, we were really good. And we were ready for places like Japan, coming back to England. And yeah, we really knew what we were doing. And I think that's the best thing when gigging is you can rehearse as much as you want in a rehearsal room, but the main thing is to get out on the road and pin it down. The more shows you can put together in one stretch is the best way.
Juno, I heard about the super performance that happened at the Ozora Festival with the Mutant Theatre. I just want to know what all went creating this amazing concept, from the backstage, the coordination, to, you know, the artist, to the rehearsals. Please tell us everything about the Mutant Theatre.
Well, I sort of covered it in maybe that five question one before, but what can I explain more? It's a very visual show. I really wanted it to be like a trance version of a Las Vegas show. So there's many costumes, like the Agnevo people from Moscow have a very sort of cinematic character-based performance where they use these guns that are like confetti. They use gas that, you know, spreads out across the sort of the audience. Doesn't kill them, by the way. Gets rid of corona, makes them cold. And Stigma from St. Petersburg are very much more LED light and orientated and have very unique costumes that are very technical. And for the track Let's Turn On, which we made a video in Moscow with them, the costumes are made out of, I don't know, maybe 3,000 or 4,000 LED lights, and they're controlled by MIDI, and you can program them to have many different shapes and signs and color changes. So those are like the costumes. Then I've got a lighting director, which is really important. You think, oh, just turn up and get good lights. No. We had to really source and find a very good lighting director, and we were lucky with Eric. And he would come into rehearsals and we'd go through everything and go through what colours are going to work best with it, and write out plans, write out movements, then he'd put it into the computer and he'd log it in. And as much with the sound, you know, the sound is obviously important with Grant, who's our engineer, who's been travelling with me for ages since Liebeck. And we'd just spend, you know, as much time as we can just sort of routining in, usually like in hotels. We'd find a big room and go in there and work. I mean, people like Maria were really good at choreography. She's one of the Stigma people. And so it was a good collaboration of everyone coming in with ideas and brain's gone dead here because it's really late at night. But yeah, so these, I'm trying to think if there's much else, really. I think we choreographed the show, and I then put a whole new list of songs. I wrote an album specifically for the Mutant Theatre. Yeah, I suppose I shouldn't forget that. And that is called the Mutant Theatre, and I suppose the most successful tracks from that are tracks like Alien, Return of the Pistolero, The Sky is Blue, The Sky is Black. And so everything was really like made specifically for the Mutant Theatre. Now the Mutant Theatre's gone, I can't really imagine us being able to do another performance. So it was like a really beautiful thing that happened. And as much as I would love to do more shows, I think the way that the world has gone with live performance, I think that's highly unlikely. So I think it's best just to like put it in a drawer and go, well, that was great. Now let's get on with the next thing.
To all our listeners out there, you know, I'm sure you've heard about the movie Matrix. Yeah, the movie Matrix. You must be wondering, why am I talking about the movie Matrix? Well, let me tell you, Juno Reactor has composed the musical score for the movie The Matrix. So Juno, how did this happen? It's huge. And how did this go?
Well, I got brought in on The Matrix 2 and Matrix 3. And I was brought in to do the electronic, like the Wachowskis showed me the Freeway Chase and said, we'd like you to score this, but we'd like you to work with Don and sort of be the bridge of the electronic and the orchestra. So come in with like orchestral ideas, come in with electronic ideas. And I knew nothing. I knew nothing really about scoring films. I'd done, you know, independent underground films, but nothing really prepared me for The Matrix. And so when I got there, they were really incredibly good to work with. And they said, we've got a music editor for you who'll help you with, you know, certain types of things that they need. And his name was Zig Gron. And the first night I met Zig, I said to him, Zig, I know nothing about this, so I need all your help. You know, give me as much help, feed me with as many ideas or how I should approach certain cues. Obviously, I'll come up with the musical ideas, but if there's like technical things or what things I should really go for to hit, what things I shouldn't hit. And so Zig was like incredible. He would, you know, we'd stay up sort of 20 hours a day. And it was fun. It was really funny working with Zig. Everything was, you know, a laugh. And it was successful. And so once I finished the Freeway Chase, they showed me the Tea House. And again, I'd recorded Goku in Japan, up by Fuji Mountain. And so that really fitted. So I already had a load of pre-record of Taiko's and this. And so I edited it up and added some musical bits. And then they kept on asking me. I remember they asked me for the Burly Brawl and other bands like Prodigy, Fluke, all these sort of bands that had to go, but they couldn't really sort of stamp it. And I very much went in with like a rock-style BPM rather than a dance-style BPM. I think it started at 170, moved to 200, then went from 200 to 250 BPM. Then finally, at the very end, it went from 250 to 300. And these were all sort of quite enjoyable technical problems to be made into reality. And that was really interesting, I thought. And Don was quite bizarre in that, because I'd say to him, well, what sort of key is it in? And he was sort of saying, well, it's in two keys. So I thought, well, that's easy. So I'll sort of put it in loads of rhythms then, if it's going to be like that. And I think that was a very successful one. But all the time that I was working on The Matrix, you know, I'd go in and meet up with the Wachowskis maybe every 2 or 3 days. And they were the best producers I've ever worked with, because they would give me, if it wasn't quite right, they'd say something that really made sense to me. And I could go back and correct it and come back, and they would be into it. And again, they were incredibly positive people. They were never, you know, you get this idea of what it's like working in Hollywood and these uber directors or producers. And yeah, they were pretty amazing people.
Juno, you've traveled to India and you've also played in Goa. I just wanted to know what you think about the music scene in India.
Well, I don't really know the music scene in India. I mean, it's really still a bit of a mystery to me. I mean, I know some of the electronic artists and, you know, like Medieval Pundits and stuff, and who I really like. I mean, they've been one of my favourite bands for a long time. And I know you've got a load of really great producers out there. And from a classical point of view, I've worked with Hamsika Iyer and other more classical musicians up in Mumbai. So it's still, you know, it's still like a green land for me. You know, I'd really like to spend a lot more time. And at the moment, I'm doing a project with what's called the Croydon Composers. And I think I'm working with a 13-year-old Indian girl and this guy who must be about, I don't know, 40, who plays like a sitar, but it's with a bow. I've forgotten the name of the instrument. And Shri. Shri's like, I think you'll know him, the bass player, really amazing bass player that plays it like a tabla. And he's in charge of the whole project. So again, it's like a learning curve. So I think there's so much to, you know, I'll more likely never learn what there is to learn from Indian music because it's so different from Western music. But learning rags and finding out more about them, you know, even back on The Matrix when I had Lakshmi Shankar come in and sing, that was interesting. And then Deepak Ram, who was playing the bansuri, he came in as well. So, you know, I'm getting to know a little bit, but obviously nowhere near what there is to learn from India.
Through those magical years with Juno Reactor and this very moment, this present on Niche Radio, I want to know from you, Juno, what next?
I'm sort of experimenting with different sort of styles of music, really, at the moment. Because of lockdown and COVID, I don't really feel like I need to do the boom, boom, boom thing at the moment. And so I'm doing very much sort of what I think is three-dimensional imagery. Call it ambient if you want, but it's not really just ambient. It's like storytelling, but mainly through sound. And I had one track that I started in 2019 that I really wanted, like a pagan violinist, Viola, to play the part. So I thought, well, who better to play that than me, because I can't play it. So I've learned over the last year to play enough of it to be able to record it. And that's put me on a strange journey because I really love playing it. I'm still pretty useless, but I get lost in playing it. I can spend 2 or 3 hours just like playing it and trying to learn the techniques of how to do it. And that's been really nice. So maybe I think, whether it's Juno Reactor or if I call it a different name, I'm not sure. There's like a new sort of sound that I want to do.
Juno, what advice would you give to the young aspiring artists out there?
Nowadays we've got like with this virus and the music business really being in free fall, but say without the virus, without the problems of health and restrictions, if it's electronic, if you're an electronic artist, I think it's good to play an instrument. I think it's really good to learn an instrument, whether it's the guitar, keyboards, violin, drums. I think maybe also in your setup for a young artist, I think it's really good to have a social media person involved in the group in a way like you might think of having a manager, or you might think of having a drummer, or I mean, they can't really replace a singer, but it's, I think nowadays that is essential because there's so much work to do that you need a dedicated person. And so if you're writing a song and you've got this social media person working with you, I think it's important that you try and work it out as a unit. The other thing I'd say is that it's good to follow waves of what's happening in music, to be aware of what's going on many different styles, platforms, try it out. And then with what you do, try and do something different. Try and cross it with something that's not usually there. Don't just be a sheep, because if you're just a sheep, you might get lucky and get a few hits or something. But you have to be brave enough to try something different, vastly different, and just have confidence in it and see how it goes. Try many different styles of music at one time and just see how it goes. See which one has life. And at the beginning of Juno Reactor, I had like, I don't know, 3 or 4 projects. And it was Juno Reactor, the one that really took off. And I think it was good in that respect for me, because Juno Reactor was always a collaborative approach. I've been in bands before where I'd had, you know, fixed people, whether it's drums or cello or whatever. I was singing, I was playing guitar. And you generally start, egos would start coming into the whole affair. And when egos start, they usually get messy and it starts getting negative. And so with Juno Reactor, the whole idea was to allow people to come in and go and come back again if they wanted to or if I wanted them to. And that way it sort of kept like quite a fresh feel to everything. And it allowed it to develop in ways that I think if it had just been a fixed lineup, it would have died many years ago. And it's, you know, new blood brings in new ideas. And, but yeah, that's my pennyworth of advice.
To all our listeners, there's not a single day that we do not play Juno Reactor's music on Niche Radio. And Juno, we are truly grateful for that. Thank you so much for sharing your journey with all our listeners. I had a super blast. I'm sure all our listeners did too. And all the best for the future.
Thank you. And thanks for inviting Juno Reactor onto your radio. And I hope when all of this is over that we can come back to India and play for the amazing audiences that I've met. And to all the people that I have met out in India, I'd like to thank you for your warmth and hospitality, and hopefully see you soon.
And yes, thank you to all our listeners for tuning in today. Do catch me again next Sunday at 10 a.m. Until then, take good care of yourselves and have a super Sunday, and enjoy this next track coming up from Juno Reactor called Baikala.